The field of the philosophy of mind has grown pretty significantly throughout the latter half of the 20th century into the 21st century. And a number of arguments have been proposed trying to understand various ways of understanding the mind, and various schools of thought have formulated around one's understanding of the mind and its physical and mental nature. So within the broader spectrum of things, we can divide every view that exists probably between two different views. And one of those views in the philosophy of mind is what is known as the physicalist view, which says that there is an exact identification between the brain and the mind, meaning that there is nothing that is inherently mental in reality. There is no mental property that is different from that which is physical. In other words, physicalism means that everything that exists in reality is inherently physical, and it can be explained by just ordinary physical processes. And so in that particular view, there is no difference between a thought and a brain state, or a particular physical happening within the physical thing that is the brain. And on the other hand, there are those who argue against physicalism, who say that there is something about the human person or the human mind that is not inherently physical, and that not everything in reality can be explained in solely physical terms. And there are other ways to explain and understand reality that the physical simply is not equipped to explain. So within those two different perspectives, a number of arguments have been raised dealing with one side or another to try to defend their arguments. Now, among the physicalists, the most popular proponents are people like Paul Churchland, Patricia Churchland, and more recently, Daniel Dennett. And in the most extreme cases, they hold to a view that is known as eliminative materialism, which says that there is no real mind or consciousness at all, that it's essentially an illusion because everything can be explained purely by the physical processes in the brain. Now, on the other side, there are those who hold to forms of what is often known as dualism. There are different ways to understand this. Some hold to property dualism or substance dualism, or myself, coming from a more Thomistic dualist perspective. And in all of these, as well as panpsychism, epiphenomenalism, there are various different ways to explain exactly what reality is and how the physical and mental make sense with one another. And one particular argument that has been very influential in some of these discussions that has been debated a lot is one that was proposed by a philosopher named Frank Jackson. This is a thought experiment that is often referred to as the Mary argument, or the Mary's room argument, or the knowledge argument for dualism or against physicalism. And this argument essentially proposes a scenario. And there is a woman named Mary. Now, this is in the future, a few hundred years in the future, when science has developed quite a bit more and we can understand a lot more about the working of our brains and the physical world than we do now. And Mary is an expertise in the field of color. So she's a neuroscientist. She understands everything scientifically that there is to know about color. But through her entire life, she has only been able to observe the world in black and white. In various ways of explaining this. One is that she's in a room where she only views the world through a black and white television screen, or we could just propose that Mary is colorblind. However you want to phrase it, the idea is that Mary can not see color. However, she is an expert in the field of color. And what particles make you see certain colors and what happens in the brain. And Mary has comprehensive knowledge scientifically about color. Say, Mary knows absolutely everything there is to know about, say, the color red. She knows exactly what's happening in the brain, exactly when people are going to see red, exactly what their brain is doing when they see red. So seemingly, according to at least her physical knowledge, coming from a traditional scientific method, she knows absolutely everything there is to know, has comprehensive knowledge about the color red. However, remember that Mary cannot actually see the color red. She has viewed the world in black and white. The argument says this: what if Mary, now already having scientifically a comprehensive knowledge of the color red, is suddenly able to see the world in color? Whether that means she sees the world no longer through that black and white television set, or perhaps her color blindness has been cured by some kind of procedure. And now all of a sudden, Mary looks at something that has the color red. And the question is, what happens to Mary? Does she experience something new? Does she gain new knowledge? And it's clear in this example that Mary does now gain some kind of knowledge that she did not have previously. Because before, she knew everything objectively from a third-person perspective about the color red, but now she has this first-person experience of seeing red. This is what is known as the qualia, aspects of the mind where you experience something for yourself, what is often referred to as the what-it-is-like nature of reality. So now she knows not just objectively through the scientific method what red is all about and how the brain processes color, but now she knows what it is like to see red. And so Mary now gains knowledge that she did not have and could not have via the scientific third-person perspective alone. So what this points to is the fact that there is a kind of knowledge that we gain that cannot be gained through scientific study alone, that cannot be gained just by an understanding of physical processes. And that's the first person understanding of reality. And that's what Mary gets when she sees the color red. So it demonstrates that there is something about knowledge that cannot be gained through just physical events. And therefore, reality itself and the mind is not purely physical. Now, there have been a number of ways to try to explain the Mary argument and argue against it to try to defend physicalism. But in my own opinion, they really don't work very well at all. Anyway, that's the Mary argument for those who are interested in this subject. If you want to find more videos on philosophy and theology, please subscribe and check out the other content on this channel. And thank you so much. We'll see you next time.